Hello, and welcome to another Century 21 Tech Talk Briefing with me, Jeff Tracy. In this briefing, I'll be providing details about the operation and technical specifications of Zero-X. The Zero-X is the solar system exploration craft designed for travel to the nine planets in our solar system. It is based at Glenfield Air Base in the United States. At an impressive 640 feet long, and with a wingspan of 436 feet, the Zero-X is one of the largest horizontally launched aircraft ever designed. Like the early spacecraft of the 20th century, the Zero-X is modular in design. I'll detail the individual components shortly, but first, I'll give you a rundown on the history and purpose of the craft. Since man's first lunar landings, humanity has yearned to explore the neighboring worlds in our solar system. After years of sending out automated rovers, it was decided that the next manned venture to the stars should focus on Mars, the red planet. To that end, a reusable spacecraft was designed. Unlike the craft of the previous century, the new ship would not be launched vertically like a rocket, but horizontally, like a conventional aircraft. The project was dubbed Zero-X, as the design was submitted by Commander Wilbur Zero and was the 10th entry received by the Solar System Exploration Project Development Team. Once the design was approved, construction began in earnest, alongside a whole new spaceport, which was built of the old Glenfield Air Force Base. The project moved along at near light speed, and in what seemed like no time at all, the Zero-X and the new spaceport were completed. The maiden flight was scheduled for mid-2064. Even in the midst of setting up our international rescue team, the boys and I couldn't help but get excited about the event. Unfortunately, disaster struck when a saboteur crippled the Zero-X shortly after launch, causing the spacecraft to crash into the ocean. Thankfully, the crew were unharmed, having used their escape unit to eject from the doomed ship. With overwhelming support from the world government and many well-known philanthropists, you might be forgiven for thinking Zero-X was the only project with its sights on Mars. But there were others. For example, Wilkin Healy, a private company based in the States, commissioned their own rocket in a bid to reach the red planet first. The Martian space probe was a far more conventional design, but it did have one unique feature, an automated countdown and launch. Delays in its construction put it in second place behind Zero-X in the race to Mars. But after the Zero-X sabotage incident, the Martian space probe had a clear lead. Taking advantage of the relative position of Mars to the Earth and the automated launch feature, the MSP was transported to a launch site in England in order to make a mid-2065 blastoff window. However, the Martian space probe also met with disaster. While crossing the Allington suspension bridge, which had been severely damaged by a storm, the colossal weight of the probe rocket and its transporter caused the bridge to collapse. Two engineers were trapped on board, and the automated countdown was started by the impact. Luckily for them, international rescue was fully operational by that time, and we mounted a successful operation to retrieve the trapped men. By the middle of the following year, the Solar System Exploration Team had completed their investigation into the Zero-X crash and decided that a second attempt to reach Mars would be made with one proviso. They asked International Rescue to oversee the launch. While initially hesitant, I agreed to their request, and Thunderbirds 2 and 3 accompanied the Zero-X as it reached orbit, despite a last-minute sabotage attempt. Before we get to what happened next, I guess I ought to tell you just how Zero-X is assembled and launched. First, the main body of the craft rolls out of the purpose-built hangar and arrives at the assembly area. Next, it is raised on a series of hydraulic supports, and the aft radio-controlled lifting body is maneuvered underneath it. The Zero-X is lowered onto the lifting body and clamped in place. A steel track is then deployed from a nearby hangar, and the forward lifting body is carried out to the Zero X. As it approaches the main ship, it is rotated into position before being lowered down and clamped in place on the fuselage. The wingtips containing the forward landing gear are folded into position, completing stage one of the Zero X assembly. The second stage of assembly begins in the control tower, where the Glenfield controller gives a final briefing to the crew before initiating embarkation procedure. The flight crew's chairs rotate and carry them into the control deck of the Martian Excursion Vehicle, or MEV, which is docked to the front of the control tower. The MEV is lowered to the ground, where it is carried out to the waiting ship on a motorized platform. The platform raises the MEV until it locks onto the front of the Zero X, and the platform is removed. Finally, a helium-strengthened nose cone is attached to the front of the MEV, and the whole spacecraft is completed. Launch clearance is given, and the huge craft fires its engines and hurtles down the runway, lifting off into the air like an ordinary aircraft. As it reaches 125,000 feet and a speed of Mach 3.2, the lifting bodies are jettisoned and returned to Glenfield under remote control. Chemical rockets are fired, boosting the craft to 7,000 knots. The nose cone is jettisoned seconds later and follows the lifting bodies back to base. The Zero X achieves orbit soon after and switches to arc jet engines for the 6-week trip to the Red Planet. The crew for the historic first mission to Mars were Captain Paul Travers, Space Captain Greg Martin, Space Navigator Brad Newman, Dr. Ray Pierce, and Dr. Tony Grant. They were prepared for the unexpected, but nothing could prepare them for what they discovered. Reaching Mars on schedule, the Martian Excursion Vehicle detached from the main body of Zero X and descended to the surface. While studying strange rock formations, the MEV used its demolition cannon to break one apart for analysis. Unfortunately, the rock formations turned out to be snake-like life forms, and returned the MEV's fire with powerful flaming balls of energy. Quickly outnumbered and outgunned, the MEV made an emergency launch and rendezvoused with Zero X before returning to Earth. The exchange of fire damaged the Zero X's radio control circuits. During re-entry, the fault caused the aft lifting body to smash into the main craft as it was about to reattach. The impact destroyed the escape circuit controls and made fitting a second lifting body impossible. Out of control and heading for a disaster, international rescue mobilized to save the crew while local authorities evacuated the forecast crash location, an area called Craigsville. With seconds to spare, Alan was able to bypass the damaged control system and jettison the crew to safety. The Zero X crashed into Craigsville, causing widespread damage, but fortunately, the area had been fully evacuated, and no lives were lost. A further Zero X mission was mounted last year, when Spectrum requisitioned the newly built Zero X to investigate mysterious signals coming from Mars. According to the data recovered from the Zero X on its return to Glenfield, the MEV discovered an alien city. As they approached, they witnessed an unknown object, possibly a weapon, turning to face them. Captain Black, the officer in command, gave orders to open fire. The city was completely destroyed, but incredibly, it was reconstructed before their eyes. We now know that it was the city of the Mysterons, and that Captain Black's actions precipitated a war of nerves against the invisible enemy within. A war that continues to this day. That concludes the briefing on Zero X, a fantastic machine with a troubled history. Be sure to tune in next time for another Tech Talk briefing. Until then, take care, FAB.